friends. This side, Rahul Magan here is a Group Chief Executive Officer of Treasury Consulting and also a venture capitalist. Today, we are going to shoot a very dedicated video about a topic exactly how to cover USD INR and using a position strangle. Of course, you might be knowing that what exactly is strangle all about, but in this, we would be covering three things. Number one, at the end of the video, we would be talking about what is my opinion about USD INR for exporter and importer. And of course, during the video, we talk about the product strangle. But I, as you know, that Treasury Consulting is always thinking in a different angle. We're going to be adding one thing, that what is InterBank? InterBank is a term which is often used across the globe, but it's used in the books also. And unfortunately, most of the business schools do not know what exactly is InterBank all about. But we are going to be talking strangle from a different angle. We would let you know that how exactly banks are covering strangle in the InterBank. So let's start with the strangle. First of all, we need to appreciate that products like strangle apparently allowed in India by RBI. This is an exception. I think this is really an exception. Sitting today, Reserve Bank of India deferred the implementation of Indian Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, Indian Accounting Standards, shortly known as NDAS or INDAS, in my parlance, for another 1 year. That doesn't matter whether the period is 1 year, more than 1 year, 2 year, 3 year. The question is the deferment. So unfortunately, we are living in an economy whereby these kind of structures are either not available, or if they are available on the paper, then the kind of acceptability we have in the banking sector is pretty limited. Henceforth, we are going to be talking about exactly how interbank market works, how banks give you that. You know that training is one of the important part of Treasury Consulting, and apart from the another business domains which we run, like private placement, consultancy, implementation and all. And in that regards, a lot of people come to me with a very primitive question, to be honest, and they are asking that, is bank acting as a facilitator? I am always going to them and saying, yes, bank act as a facilitator, because banks, whatever you covered with the banks, banks take up a counter position in the interbank market. Now that is up to a bank whether how deep is the interbank market. So sitting today, Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan Chase, Standard Chartered, they hold the deepest interbank market of the globe. If GS want, GS can cover their exposure with any bank of the globe. You just name it. You name Chase, Standard Chartered, UBS, Barclays, HSBC, Deutsche, ANZ, Westpac, Commonwealth Bank of Australia, National Bank of Australia, Indian public sector banks, the different public sector banks of the respective countries. You just name that. They are able to cover with any bank. Now the question here is that how exactly they cover. This is what we are going to be discussing here, and of course at the end I am going to give you my opinion, but exactly I think about USD INR. What is my opinion about USD INR, and this is going to be the mathematical exercise. You can see that calculator is in my hand, and you know that I do not use any obsolete calculator. I prefer using scientific calculator because this is the best way of computation, to be honest. So strangle is a strategy which is used by the corporates who disrespect one common law, and that law is the law of natural hedging. First of all, we need to appreciate that out of 100, we have more than 95 companies who do not have an appropriate treasury function in place. That is a hard reality. And especially in the companies like India, that ratio goes to 98 out of 100. Who do not have an appropriate treasury. So my definition of the appropriate treasury is the treasury who should be working. So if I say that out of 100, more than 80 companies we have who do not have a treasury, and whatever 20 companies we have, they out of 20, 18 companies who are not running the treasury in the right way, and only two exceptions like RIL, Reliance Industries Limited and L&T, they work in a very preferable way how our treasury should be running. Of course, the scope of improvement is always there. There is no doubt about that. There is no scope of improvement. Scope of improvement is always there. So strangle is a strategy which is generally suitable for the companies like RIL, Reliance Industries Limited, companies like L&T, those who have no respect for natural hedging. All those people, those who are not aware about natural hedging. Now the natural hedging is a concept whereby you know, you are having an export position of $1 billion while you have an import position of $1.2 million, or it could be alternatively also, it's just an example. So you have an export position of $1 billion while you have an import position of $1.2 million, so the net payable you would be covering is $0.2 million. You will not be covering more than $0.2 million provided you are a big supporter of a natural hedging. Now, I am not a supporter of a natural hedging, so as the RIL, Mukesh Ambani Group, they would be covering 1 plus 1.2, which is total 2.2 million. And of course, range forward is one of the best strategies, Seagull is one of the best strategies, but unfortunately, Strangle is never being taken into consideration for that, and I think the Strangle, the respect what Strangle deserves actually, Strangle is not getting in option. So today we are going to talk about how Mukesh Ambani Group would be covering buy side and the sell side exposure at the same time in using Strangle. All those people need to understand that we can get the same done using Seagull also. We already have a video about Seagull on our YouTube channel. But the difference is that Seagull is, in practical terms, is a 5-leg strategy. Theoretically it's a 3-leg. So one is the buy side and two is the sell side, or one is the sell side, two is the buy side. But it's 3 is not 3, it is practically 5, you know. Similarly, Strangle is theoretically 2-leg strategy, but practically it's a 3-leg strategy. And we are going to show that. So we assume, here we are not taking an example of RIL, rather I have used one IT companies. Reason of IT companies is that I wanted to make one thing clear, that IT companies also takes product like Strangle, and I have assumed the company TCS. Tata Consultancy Services. So TCS requires no introduction in India and worldwide. They are a very good IT company, and I think closer to 15 odd billion dollar of top line. I think next to Cognizant, second largest IT company we have in India. It's just I think 15 some billion dollar, and Cognizant is closer to $19 billion. So the difference is little wide, but still they are the second largest IT company. So let's assume that few things. So the counterparty here is the TCS. The bank is covering TCS, Tata Consultancy Services India. Let me clarify one thing outrightly, that we are talking about TCS India. This is not a corporate law clause. So why we are talking about TCS India is that exactly which counterparty I am covering. We are talking about TCS India because TCS India is doing a business for Microsoft, assuming. And they are doing some IT related work for Microsoft, for which they are raising the billing to Microsoft. Once they raise the billing to Microsoft, you know, the actual work is being imparted from Bangalore, or maybe Gurgaon, maybe Delhi, maybe at some place of India, Hyderabad, any part. The operating cost is Indian rupee. So the invoice is done in US dollar, while the operating cost is in Indian rupee. Henceforth, TCS, Tata Consulting Services India, is having an exposure of USD INR, which they need to be covered. Had it been some other company, there are many IT companies I know, in fact ITES companies I know, they are covering their exposure on a spot basis, and I call this height of idiocy, that you are covering your exposure on a spot basis. But anyways, we are not yet discussing that. And another thing we don't discuss, TCS is a very, very innovative company actually. If you look at their annual report, you would get to know how they are covering their exposure. They are covering their exposure in a unique way. And I think it's the only company in Indian IT sector who do cover using freestanding hedges. I don't know how many people, those who are watching this video, understand what exactly is freestanding hedges and how do it work. But TCS is the only company who do cover that, and that's preferably good. Plus, let's assume that TCS is setting up another delivery center in Bangalore. So you know that it's an IT company, they keep expanding their business, they keep getting their projects, they have a huge workforce, if I'm not mistaken. Over 300,000 people alone working for TCS in India, globally. So it's a huge workforce actually. So they are setting up another delivery center in Bangalore. For that, they are importing, say, chairs, furnitures, fixtures, glasses, computers, softwares, hardwares, expensive hardwares. So there is an import requirement of $1 million. So let's, if there would be any idiotic company, what they would have done a natural hedging. So I have an import position, I have an export position, let's wind it up. But apparently this is not the same. What TCS is actually doing is, TCS is saying I have an import position because of my delivery center, you know, and I have an export position, the work which is being delivered to Microsoft. So I am covering both. So the total position is 2, is not 0. I still say 99% company in India would make this at zero. But companies like TCS would make this as 2. 1 plus 1 equals to 2. And we will discuss how bank would be covering this. We assume that the bank who will be giving him the position is the Chase India. Chase is shortly JP Morgan Chase India. So what TCS would be doing, you know, in this we have taken out an example. TCS would create, you know, what TCS would be doing. TCS is here. Now the pricing which we have taken is actually from Reuters and Bloomberg, live pricing which we have taken. And many of you would be surprised to know that if I will give a statement that Indian rupee touched 100. Oh, what would if I give a statement that Indian rupee touched more than 100? I know there are many people who do not like that, and what they do, they will definitely dislike the video, and they are of that nature. I don't care what they actually doing. You know, it's the second largest YouTube channel and would be the first largest soon. That my word. We would overtake Khan Academy before 2025 at any consideration. Teji Consulting have the sufficient money to overtake Khan Academy soon. Anyways, back to the topic. We have taken the pricing from Reuters and Bloomberg, and this pricing suggests that sitting today, the price of a zero cost strangle, I repeat, the price of a zero cost strangle, which effectively meant that TCS India will pay nothing and receive nothing. And the most innovative central bank of the globe, which is Reserve Bank of India, would be very happy. I call them most innovative from a negative angle. So don't take this as a positive angle, right? They are nowhere innovative in nature. They are not even eye of innovative. So forget that. So the most innovative central bank of the globe, RBI, is actually would be very happy because TCS is not receiving. Now in this buy call, TCS would be paying premium. While in the buy put, TCS would also be paying premium. But ultimately we have created a structure that TCS is neither paying nor receiving. I know there are many people who do not agree to that. People have no access to financial terminals. They tend to feel that how can that be possible, but that is their problem, but that is not my problem. So what exactly is this? This is buy and this is sell. This is buy and this is sell. Now this is what you call tenders as a delivery center TCS is creating, and this you will tell them as a the invoicing to the Microsoft. And here we have created how TCS would be hedged in the interbank market by Chase. That is, by Chase. Now how it would happen? Let's assume a Tokyo cut. I don't know how many people know what exactly is Tokyo cut. So in options, actually options I have three dates. One is the acquisition date, example today. And it's a 12-month structure we assume of $1 million. So repeat again, the counterpart is TCS, the option is deliverable. The strangle for exporter, and of course the pay side as well. Period is 12 months, bank is JP Morgan Chase India, premium is zero. So there is nothing to pay, nothing to receive. Let it be very clear. You know, so you know what happened, there are 3 dates. So the acquisition date is today, 23rd March. 12 months would be 22nd March 2020, but the settlement would happen on 21st March. Because Indian rupee traded T plus 2. And since it is traded T plus 2, the Tokyo cut would come 2 working days before. I do not have a calendar in my hand. I am assuming that 21st March is a working day. 21st March 2020. So the settlement would happen at 21st March 2020. But basically, sorry, the Tokyo cut will decide at 21st March 2020. But the settlement would happen at 20th March 2020. Because 2 working days before. And the settlement would happen as 22nd March 2020. So assume the Tokyo cut is selling today, Indian rupee is closer to 69. You can assume that 1 year down the line, let's take at 75. If the Tokyo cut would turn out to be the 75, then would TCS buy? Now here TCS have the right to buy. Would TCS do that? Definitely not. In our parlance, this is known as worthless. Would TCS sell at 65.50 if the market is at 75? Definitely not. However, this will create a notional gain because TCS will sell in the market. This will create a notional gain of 9.5 rupees per dollar for the TCS. Now this is the worst, I assume. Assuming Indian rupee turn out to be 60, and this is next to impossible, but still. Would TCS buy here at 130? No. Would TCS sell here? Absolutely. They would be getting a gain of 5.5. So using two Tokyo curves in an extreme eventuality whereby Indian rupee touch 75. But anyways, I don't term this as an extreme eventuality. The reason being, 75 is something which is quite probable in India. You know, a fractured mandate is on the way. And I think that the way Indian economy is heading, I don't think that 75 is something which, thinking about 75 is something which is wrong. 75 is something which is within the line, within the fire line. So in army, there is a word called you're within the fire line. I think 75 is within the fire line. And I think that if the way Indian economy is headed, like today also, there is one credit rating agency, I think it's Fitch, who reduced Indian GDP growth to 6.8%. Although every time I'm doubting what exactly the numbers of GDP growth being quoted by both IMF and Fitch and other rating agencies are absolutely fake. But still, they have reduced to 6.8%. And there are a lot of numbers which we have around, like the corporate health and all these things. They're not very good numbers, actually. So apparently speaking, I think that 75 is basically in a fire range, if I speak from an army parlance. Turning out to be 60 is relatively very difficult, and I think it's next to impossible because there is not a concrete thing which we can see right now in Indian economy which can make it to 60. But God knows, you know, government will come up, new government will make something very realistic changes, drastic changes, and apparently speaking, it's a little difficult and doubtful, but God knows. This is where the story would end for most of the treasuries. And I think I should wind up the video. Most of the treasury story ended because people feel that I have taken a position from a bank. Why do I worry? Now, I got a gain of somewhere, a notional gain of 9.5. Here I got a real gain of 5.5. Why do I worry? What a bank do? Why do I worry? It's not my job. No, that's your job. You should know exactly how it works if you really wish or turn out to be a successful corporate treasurer in the world of foreign exchange. Now exactly how this happened. Every coin is having two sides, head and tail. If I term this as a head, this is tail. If I term this as a tail, this is head. Immediately once banks will give you the position, banks will take a counter position in the market. So bank have given you the buy position, bank will take a sell position in the market. But we are talking about a bank whose name is JP Morgan Chase India. And since we are talking about JP Morgan Chase India, we need to understand that Chase India is having an interbank desk which is directly operating across the globe. Chase, HSBC, Standard Chartered, UBS, GS, at least three foreign banks who are actively participating in the corporate banking in India, Chase, Standard Chartered, Deutsche, little extent BNP Paribas, they are the one, those who operate an interbank desk outside India, US, Singapore and different. And let's assume that this interbank desk is exactly in Singapore. Even if you assume to be US and Europe, it doesn't matter because the pricing remains intact. So whatever non-deliverable desk you are assuming, the pricing remains intact. Now let's go to the same Tokyo cut. Now what JP Morgan would be doing, or the Chase would be doing, Chase would be creating the reverse position in the market. Here they would be creating sell call, which is this reverse, and sell put, which is this reverse. And 99% of the intelligent people in the globe tend to feel that the strike price of that option contract which Chase has given to you remains the same if they're going to take in the interbank market. I repeat, the contract which Chase has given you at a relevant strike price, which is 135 to 65.5, it remains same when they're going to take it at the interbank position. Definitely not. It is pricing. Here you are at the buy side, here you are at the sell side. So the same Reuters and Bloomberg suggested us that, boss, here the pricing is 120 to 62. So before moving further, you need to apparently understand that here it is 135, here is 120. Now here it is 65.5, here it is 62. So you need to come out of this phobia that bank, once bank cover in the interbank position, they give you the same, they get the same rate. Absolutely not. They definitely not get the same rate. Although the time is very limited, else we would have told you that how the traders covering delta also. The difference between this and this, they are covering using delta. But everything we don't put here because time is also limited, you know, time is always a factor. So here what happens, suppose that now here we assume that here they have taken a position from Standard Chartered India. Standard Chartered India. And this non-deliverable position they have taken from Standard Chartered Singapore. 99.99% people believe that why do they take a position from Standard Chartered Singapore? Now, for your knowledge, let me confirm you that the premium which you're going to be receiving here is absolutely zero. Because one side you have put, one side you have call, one side you have the put, the premium is absolutely zero. So please be rest assured about that. And this non-deliverable you are taking from Singapore. Now let's take the same 75 Tokyo cut. Because if the Tokyo cut is 75 for TCS, it is same for Chase and Standard Chartered. Now here who have the right? Standard Chartered. Would stand now JP Morgan Chase is at sell call. And who is at the buy call? Standard Chartered. Now Standard Chartered, would Standard Chartered be buy from Chase at 120? If market is at 75, no. Alternatively, would Standard Chartered be selling to Chase India if at 62, if the market is at 75? No. In our parlance, worthless. Take the same Tokyo cut, 60. Would Standard Chartered be buy at 120 if the market is at 60? No. Would Standard Chartered be selling at 62 if the market is at 60? Of course. There is a loss of 2 rupees to Chase India. And not to worry, there is a third leg also there. Now what is this third leg? Is a non-deliverable forward with the 1 year, because we have assumed option to be the 1 year. Sitting today, Indian rupee 1 year is at 72.5. We have taken from Reuters and Bloomberg. Now how exactly it happens here, when it is 75, they have taken a sell side position at 75. It effectively meant that they are losing closer to minus 2.5 rupees which they need to pay upfront. Which they need to pay upfront to the Standard Chartered India. In the eventuality of the 60, they would be getting a gain of 12.5 minus whatever 2 rupees of loss. The total should be 10.5. This is how banks covering in the interbank positions. 99.99% people end up their life, end up the discussions, business schools, professors, teachers, the so-called B school of India, and also a few in Singapore, they don't teach you what exactly is interbank. Remember that bank always end up as a facilitator. There is no doubt about that. Whether it's a Goldman Sachs or it is Chase India, Standard Chartered, UBS, whosoever. Every bank acts as a facilitator. But the difference is that once you're acting as a facilitator, how deep is your trader, how active is your trader, and what position he's taking. The apparent mind ends up that the position which you have given to TCS 135 to 65.5, the same position what Chase India is getting from Standard Chartered, definitely not. And apparent mind end up in the notion that Chase India will not clear a wall, a Chinese wall, between that option that is non-deliverable. They do. If you create a non-deliverable position, that's surely going to help you a lot. This is what Strangle we wanted to present you. Now to wind up this video, we just would like to give our view of Indian rupee. I think that Indian rupee is 69 right now due to the multiple factors, and one of the important factors is not Indian leather, it's a Federal Reserve factor, because they not hike the rate. We're going to have separate videos soon on that factor. I think relatively it's not done. Federal Reserve should continue to hike. That is my way of looking at it. But of course, I am not Donald Trump, neither I am Powell. So I have no right to comment. But I think Federal Reserve should continue to hike. And the biggest mistake Federal Reserve this time, that they have given a statement that you should not expect any hike in 2019, rather you expect one hike in 2020. Compared to the statement which they have given in 18, that you should expect three hikes in 2019 and at least two hikes in 20, I think that is the wrongest move Fed has done. Fed should not open its cards in the public domain. This has led to the appreciation of the Indian rupee. Apart from that, I don't see there is another factor which led to the appreciation of the Indian rupee, especially when you are in the year of general elections. And I strongly feel that the importers should start cover their positions using range forwards, and while exporters should take up a position using Siegel. Apparently speaking, I will never suggest importer to take Siegel. Reason is that most of the time they believe in the national hedging, while in case of exporters they have something to buy it out as well due to their commitments, right? I see that importers should come using range forward, and the pricing which you are getting is very attractive. So if without shooting this video, if I would have told you that Indian rupee touched 100, most of the people assume that I am an idiot, but I am not an idiot. You can see that the pricing which we are getting is 135 and here we are getting it 120. So Indian rupee has already crossed 100 in the option market, and I think that is a very right move. I think if you take range forward today and Siegel today, range forward as an importer and Siegel as an exporter, it's a very preferred move if you really wish to save your company. But of course, if your treasury function is not capable, you're most welcome to continue with the obsolete instrument, which is forward contract, and be happy. Once the losses will come, stay happy, because there is not a single factor which you see in the economy which can make Indian rupee to 60 or probably 58. Everything is against Indian economy, and general election is round the corner. With this, Treasury Consulting would like to thank you very much, and more videos are on the way. We are going to be launching a flash of videos in the next 1.5 months. Today we are 611 and second largest YouTube channel, and hopefully by May end it would be more than 750 in nature. With this, Treasury Consulting would thank you. You know my mobile number, 9899242978. While my email is rahul.magan@treasuryconsulting.in, and don't forget to visit our fixed income platform www.fixedincome.global. We thank you very much and have a wonderful time ahead.